A warm welcome to learners. Today we will be discussing a very important topic of management, that is leadership. So after completing this video lecture, you will be able to define leadership, outline the characteristics of leadership, then you will be able to discuss the importance of leadership, identify the qualities of a good leader, and then at the end of the lecture we will be discussing different leadership styles, that is autocratic leadership, democratic leadership and free reign leadership, and then we will discuss laggard management system. So what is leadership? Leadership is a process of influencing and supporting others to work enthusiastically towards achieving the objectives. So a leader needs to be goal oriented. They will have specific goals for their subordinates, and to become a successful leader, he or she should have certain followers who trust the leaders. Suppose, for example, if we talk about the cricket team. So in a cricket team, there is one leader who will guide the other players, and the success of the entire team depends on the captain of the team, isn't it? So now we will come to the definition of leadership. So in general term, we can define leadership as the ability of a manager to induce subordinates to work with zeal and confidence. That means when we say some leaders were successful, some leaders were unsuccessful. Why? Because it depends on their ability to how they will induce the subordinates to perform a specific task. So when we talk about the features of leadership, it is a personal quality of a leader which makes him fit to exert an interpersonal influence. So to become a leader, there should be some followers. It is the relationship between a leader and his followers which arises out of their functioning for common goals. Because if some task needs to be performed, then there should be some person who will guide the others in an organization. Generally, in any organization, manager performs the role of a leader and he or she leads the others to perform the specific task. So laying down objectives and policies for the followers, motivating them and coordinating their efforts to accomplish the objectives all comes under the umbrella of leadership. The style of leadership may differ from situation to situation. There are different theories of leadership which we will be discussing in other classes. So depending on the situation, the leadership styles differs. It includes the ability to persuade others and to motivate them for working objectively to accomplish certain specific goals. It is necessary to guide the followers in attaining common goals. It is a process through which the leader exercises an influence on the members of a group. There is an unequal distribution of authority among the leaders and group members in leadership. Now we will discuss the functions of leader. Most important thing of leadership is to determine the goal, because the leader decides what needs to be performed. So they set some specific goals for the subordinates. Then organization of activities. A good leader divides the organizational task among the employees in a systematic way, so that there should not be any conflict and the task can be accomplished successfully. Then accomplishing coordination. A leader accomplishes the organizational goals by directing and unifying the efforts of all the individuals of a group. Then providing guidance. A leader provides guidance to their subordinates wherever necessary. Then another function is by building employee morale. A leader needs to motivate their employees in such a way that the employees should perform to their maximum. Because without motivation, the employees will not perform as per their expectation. Then facilitating change. If any change occurs in any organization, then the leader facilitates those changes among the workers. And they need to motivate all the employees in the organization so that their morale should boost up. Another function of leadership is controlling. In any organization, there is always limited resources. So when some tasks were performed by the subordinates, the leader needs to check whether they were performing in proper way or not. So there should be some control among the subordinates, because if the leader does not control the activities of the subordinate may waste many resources of the organization. So the leader should take a look about the performance of the subordinates and check whether they were going in a proper direction or not. If they were deviating from the direction, then the leader needs to take them back to the proper direction. Then another important function is setting an example. So when we talk about the leader performs the task what he wants to do from the subordinates, and he shows it as an example. So when the subordinate will see the activities and task of the leader, they will be motivated to perform just like the leader has performed. Then again, another very important function is the guidance. The leader needs to guide properly their subordinates. So when the leader will guide their subordinates, whether the subordinates were motivated from that guidance or whether the subordinate dislikes the leader need to check those things. Sometimes what happens, the leader, he is guiding the subordinates, but the subordinates were not following the leaders. They may be dissatisfied with the leader and they may be demotivated. So in that situation, the leader should check himself, whatever fault he has done, and then he need to modify his activities, and then he need to guide the subordinates in proper direction. So these were the basic functions of a leadership. Now we will discuss the qualities of a good leader. First thing is intelligence. A good leader should have enough intelligence to guide their subordinates. Then they should be able to initiate and have the creative ability so that they can go for something new and they can innovate something better for the organization. Next is power of judgment. They should have the ability to judge proper so that there should not be any biasness among the individuals. Then they should have proper vision and foresight. They should be futuristic because they need to guide the followers. Then they should have proper mental and emotional maturity, because if a leader thinks something very emotionally, or they were not able to guide properly their subordinates, they were biased for their subordinates, that particular leader cannot be successful. Then there should be option for flexibility among the leadership situations. Then the leader should have the technical competence. The leader should be well knowledged about their particular qualities, about their task. They should have self-confidence among themselves. So to become a good leader, you should have the self-confidence in yourself. If you are confident enough in your decisions, then only you can guide the subordinates, and then subordinates will listen to your decisions. And those leaders should have the good human relation attitudes. All the leaders, whoever is successful, they may not be effective leader. When we talk about the success of a leadership and the effectiveness of a leadership, it's two different things. A manager who can get all the things done from his or her subordinates may be a very successful leader. But if the subordinates doesn't like him, or if the subordinates feels very stressed under his guidance, then he may not be very effective one. Then another important qualities of leader is inspire others. A good leader always inspires the followers. He or she does the work first by himself. Then they show as an example to their followers. And when the followers will see their task, what their leaders were doing, then they will be motivated to perform similarly. Then another good quality is a leader should be a good communicator, because the leader needs to give the guidance, give the command to their subordinates. So if a leader is not a good communicator, then the flow of information will be disrupted. Suppose, for example, a good leader not only commands their subordinates, he or she also listens to their subordinate, because only the two-way communication were most effective compared to the one-way communication. So to become a good leader, a leader should have the qualities to become a good communicator. Then another very important quality is decision-making capabilities. A leader should have the decision-making capabilities. As a manager, as a leader, when they take decision, it should be for the betterment of the organization. So a leader needs to take decision. Either they need to take prompt decision if the crisis arises, or maybe with the help of the subordinates, they can take decisions. So from this diagram, you can see that a leader can be either successful or unsuccessful. Again, a successful leader may be effective leader or may be ineffective. So there are certain factors which influences the leadership style. First thing is time consideration. Availability of time for completing a task is very important. If we are running crisis of time, then the leadership decision will be different from that of when we have plenty of time. Then other factor is relationship. What kind of relationship the leader is having with his followers? If the leader has a cordial relationship with his followers, then he can easily get the things done through the followers. Then information. Whether the leader has got proper information to perform that particular task. So sometimes what happens, the leader has got the required information and he takes the decision by his own. And in some cases what happens, the leader needs to seek the information from the followers and then they take decision based on their participative decision making process. Then the knowledge of task. Earlier we have discussed that a leader should possess certain skills. Those skills were your information, knowledge about the work and then human relations. So they should have the proper knowledge of task. When we talk about the internal matter, the competency, experience, moral and other factors associated with the team or the members of the team were very important. Then whether the employees were under stress or they were not under stress, it also influences in the leadership style. There are certain leaders who may not be in any organization, but their power, their characteristics, their philosophy is influenced by other people. Suppose for example, Gautam Buddha. So he is a kind of leader whom most of the people follows because of his characteristics, because of the things he spread among the people. Then we can talk about Shankar Deva, like other gurus were there who guides their followers in a very distinct ways. Again, there are some political leaders who also influences their subordinates. So in a society we can see different types of leaders emerges, but in any organization the leadership qualities can be possessed in specific ways. So in any organization the manager performs the role of a leader. Generally, we have three different styles of leadership. Those were your autocratic style of leadership, democratic style of leadership, and free-range style of leadership. So first, we will discuss about autocratic style of leadership. Under this autocratic style of leadership, all the decision-making powers were centralized under the leader, and he or she takes the decision by themselves. There is no initiative from the subordinates. The leader only orders the subordinate to perform the task. So this type of leadership situation arises in case of emergency. Suppose for example when we think about the military services. So here the autocratic style of leadership arises. So certain conditions were there under which the autocratic style of leadership arises. Those were the leader is running short of time. Then the leader has all the information to solve the particular problem. The employees of the organization have full confidence on the leader. Moreover, they are well motivated and believe that the leader has adopted the particular style of leadership, keeping the best interest of the team in his mind. The leader requires a high level of productivity from an inexperienced team or individual. The pressure of finishing the assigned task is more. on the higher authority in the organizational structure of positional hierarchy. The team may be placed at risk if it cannot finish the assigned task within the given time period. Then we will discuss the second type of leadership style, that is democratic leadership style. So democratic leadership style admires the decision-making process by a group of people. Here a leader gives instruction after consulting the group. However, the final decision-making authority lies with the leader. So this kind of leadership practices, when a leader may adopt this style when the situation is unfavorable for a team, that means the team is unlikely to meet its goals and there is only a little ray of hope. In this case, the leader and subordinates can make a try to win the game with joint efforts. The situation is not serious enough as like as the autocratic leadership style. So on the democratic leadership style, the leader can discuss with their subordinates to take any decision. Then we will go to the third type of leadership style, that is free rein leadership style. So in this style, the leader does not lead but leaves the group entirely to self. This approach is most common with experienced team carrying out routine activities with the ability to analyze situation and determine what needs to be done and how to do it. Such leader allows maximum freedom by giving a free hand to the subordinates in deciding their own policies and methods. They don't interrupt the subordinates. They gives full freedom to the subordinates to perform their task. This style benefits the self-motivated team members looking for new responsibilities and challenges. Here the leader acts as an umpire and coordinator of information. Through this leadership style, a leader can assess the capability of his team members in performing their responsibilities. This style is suitable when a leader has full trust and confidence in the people below him. But it is not fair that you can blame others when the things go wrong. So we have discussed these three styles of leadership. First one is your autocratic leadership, then democratic leadership, and then free rein leadership. Depending on the situation and depending on the types of the organization, these three types of leadership style varies and uses differently. Now we will discuss Likert's management system. According to Likert management system, of an organization has an influence on the efficiency of that organization and its departments. Likert categorized the system of management into the following four categories. First is, under system 1, it is exploitative authoritative. So in this type of management, with a persistent distant relationship between superiors and their subordinates in an organization, the employees have to abide by the decisions made by the managers and those with a higher status than them. Communication flows from top to bottom, and there is use of fear and threat by the management of an organization to make sure that the employees complete the task. Second system is benevolent authoritative system. So this system is like exploitative authoritative system only, and here also the management takes the decision by their own and impose it to the subordinates. But here in some cases they ask the subordinate also for taking decisions. The third system is consultative system. Under this system, the management asks the subordinates for decision making process. So here in this type of management system, subordinates are tried to be motivated by reward. Instead of punishment, they provide reward to the subordinates who performs better. There is a partial involvement of subordinates in the decision-making process. Management admires their subordinates' ideas and opinions and uses their valuable suggestions in constructive way. And the last and the fourth system is participative system. In this system, management has complete confidence in their subordinates There is free flow of communication in all directions. That means from managers to subordinates and vice versa. Here, subordinates are actively involved in the decision-making process and they can comfortably express their opinions in front of the management. So, today we have discussed the definition of leadership. Then we have discussed qualities and characteristics of leadership. Then we have discussed about the styles of leadership. And at the end of this lecture, we have discussed Likert's leadership systems. Thank you.